This is the Barry Richard Show, WBSM On Demand.
Without further ado,
WBSM presents The Barry Richard Show, streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, The Barry Richard Show.
Welcome back to the program, 208 on a Wednesday afternoon, 508-996-0500. And I don't know if you knew about this. I didn't know about this. I just heard about this today and thought I'd share it with you. Not that this is a major news story or anything, but just sometimes interesting things come across my radar screen, and I feel that you might be interested to know about it. Hillary Clinton. Did you know that Hillary Clinton was producing a Broadway musical? I, honest to God, I didn't make this up. Hillary Clinton's feminist Broadway musical is called Suffs. L-U-F-F-S. Suffs. And apparently it's having a tough time at the box office, despite receiving a whole bunch of Tony Award nominations and an outpouring of absolute just amazing praise from the press. Suffs is a nearly three-hour musical about the rise of the suffragette movement, featuring a cast comprised entirely of women and gender non-binary performers. No wonder it's struggling. And playing to 81% capacity last week while dipping to 78% capacity the week before, according to data from the Broadway League. Those figures spell potential disaster for a new show that should still be drawing big crowds during Broadway's peak season, the month before the Tony Awards. To put the numbers in perspective, the new Broadway musical, Lempicka, just posted a closing notice after playing to 83% capacity last week. So, Hillary Clinton, Broadway producer. Former First Lady and two-time presidential candidate attended the show's opening last month. She's promoted the show in several TV interviews, including stops at NBC's The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon and CBS Sunday Morning. Well, no wonder. Nobody watches that stuff. Got to go on Fox News if you want to promote it. People will see it there, right? Well, I didn't even know about that. Social Security. Social Security. Yesterday, a gentleman called and suggested that Social Security is an entitlement. Is a socialist program that seniors should not be getting, and I thoroughly disagree. Is there a better program than Social Security? There may be, but my view on Social Security is that it's a deal that we made with old people. You can't all of a sudden say, hey, you know what? We're not going to follow through with that. We were talking about Medicare yesterday, but we've talked about Social Security in the same vein in the past. Social Security's trust funds are headed toward depletion. And without a fix from Congress, retirees will see steep payment cuts in less than 10 years. It's according to a Fox Business Online. The annual Social Security trustees report this week said the Old Age and Survivors Insurance Trust Fund is on track to reach insolvency in 2033, at which point benefits would be cut by 21%. If Social Security's Disability Insurance Trust Fund were combined with the Old Age and Survivors Insurance Trust Fund, which would require a change in the law. The funds would be able to pay the total scheduled benefits until 2035. But if reforms are not implemented by that time, payers can expect a 17% reduction in their checks. Following the release of the report, President Biden issued a statement saying that he will keep strengthening Social Security and that he is committed to extending Social Security solvency by asking the highest income Americans to pay their fair share without cutting benefits or privatizing Social Security. Social Security faces a whole host of problems. One of the big problems is that the account was raided time and time again. But the other big problem is the baby boom age. Baby boomers got old on us. I'm a baby boomer, and I'm now in that Social Security age group. I'm not collecting Social Security because I'm still working, and I'm not getting Medicare because I'm still working. But the day will come when I will be drawing in. A lot of boomers will be that have not begun to already. And the U.S. has an aging population, says Fox Business. More than 67 million of whom receive Social Security benefits, and the older an American is, the more likely they are to vote. So many politicians shy away from discussing reforms of the programs at all. And I don't think that that's a very responsible thing to do. I think the problem is we have a problem, and we need to discuss and we need to figure out what we're going to do about it. And by not talking about it, you know, it's kind of like the border crisis that we've had. Politically, it's been a third rail issue for years and years and years. Abortion, Social Security reform, immigration, they've all been third rail issues that nobody's wanted to touch. But problem is real. It's got to be talked about. If no reforms are made, says Fox Business, the same Americans who receive Social Security benefits now, particularly those who rely on the benefits, face a significant threat to their income come 2033. Just a short time from now. But I mean, again, this was a deal that we struck with people. If you want to go forward, I know I remember George W. Bush had talked about, you know, private investment accounts and so on and so forth. That didn't go over well for the same reason, because politically it wasn't expedient to talk about it, right? Can't talk about Social Security. Oh, my God, look at the Republicans want to cut Social Security. People are also working longer into life. I'll tell you what, though. I'm 66. You know, I wrestle with this all the time. Part of me would love to be retired. And then my, you know, the other side of me wakes up and says, you don't have any money, so you can't retire. But I mean, I would love to retire and just travel the world. Wouldn't you like to do that? So the other part says, no, the reality is stupid. You got to pay your rent, you got to eat. So it looks like you're going to work for a while. But I think most of us are looking at probably working until we die, right? Or someplace close to that. A lot of people on Social Security having a tough time. But Social Security was a bargain. It was never intended to be a retirement program, though. But, I mean, we're living in a world where 61% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck. Credit card debt has never been higher. And not enough people to put money away. Seniors vote. So it does make a difference. All right, 508-996-0500. We'll start at the top. You're next to WBSM. Good afternoon.
Hey, Barry.
Hey.
Hey, talking about Social Security and the problems that they have, Sweden actually had the same exact problem. They were facing insolvency with their Social Security in the 90s. And they did exactly what George W. Bush did. They privatized a percentage of it. And now it's completely solvent. So it's worked, and it's worked in this in the so-called socialist utopia of Sweden. And there's a lot of different things about Sweden and Sweden, Swedish economy that.
Yeah, but do you know what the population of Sweden is?
It's significantly smaller than ours. No, I understand that.
But the population of Sweden, I just looked it up while you were talking, 10 million people.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
What is the population of the United States?
375 million.
Somewhere around there, okay? Give or take a couple of million, right? Does Sweden have the population, have the problem that we have with social program dependency?
Do they have the problem with social program
dependency? Well, look at the number of people in this country that are on some kind of benefits program, right?
Yeah, that's the majority of Swedes. Right, majority of Swedes are.
I'm talking about like some welfare program where they're not contributing to the society. My guess would be that they probably have pretty close to full employment in Sweden, right?
Yeah, just like us. Exactly. Yeah,
well, I don't think we have pretty close to full employment here. I mean, I think we've got a lot of people that are working in part-time jobs or jobs or multiple jobs, or they're underemployed or whatever. So, but we also have a lot of people that don't work. We also have a lot of people that are millions of people that have come here from other countries that were providing food and medical and housing. Are they doing that in Sweden?
Yeah, they're literally doing there's significant amount of people on some sort of a social safety. They're known for it, right? Their social safety net and their welfare state is significantly broader.
Okay,
than
so how are they paying for it? If they have a similar system to ours in terms of the number of people that are feeding at the public trough, how are they paying for that?
Everybody's working. They're literally...
Well, no, you just told me that everybody's feeding at the trough.
No. Everybody's on a social program, even though they're still working. Similarly, like to our SNAP benefits, right? A lot of working families.
Well, no, there's a difference between socialism as it exists in Sweden. In Sweden, you pay probably 75% tax rate, okay? And then the government provides you. Actually, you pay for yourself with medical. And they provide you with daycare. They provide you with all of these different things that you need. So you're essentially giving them your paycheck at the end of the week, and they're paying your bills. But they don't have the problems that we have in this country in terms. It's like when you look at a city and you look at a town around here, and you're trying to compare. Well, the property tax rate in Acushnet compared to the property tax rate in New Bedford, it's apples and oranges, because in New Bedford you've got all of the folks with social needs that are not contributing, that the taxpayers are paying for. And you've got greater needs in terms of you need more school seats, you need more firemen, you need more policemen, you need all kinds of things. So Sweden's needs are significantly less.
Oh, no, I completely agree. What I'm trying to say is that they have...
So you can't compare Sweden. You can't say, well, Sweden is doing this with retirement and they're having a great job. Why don't we do it here? Because it's a totally different situation.
Well, you brought up taxes, right? One of the things that Sweden does is that you are exempt. Every working person in Sweden, their first $54,000 is tax exempt at the federal level. $54,000. Now, on top of that, after that first $54,000, it's a 20% flat tax rate. That's it. That's all you pay. 20% flat tax at the federal level. Now, the majority of your social programs are funded via your sales tax and also at your state level, not at the federal level. But what I'm saying is on a broad sense, we have to actually look outside the box and how do we save Social Security? How do you save it? I think George W. Bush had a good idea in privatizing a portion of it, 3%, and put that into a retirement account for your future benefits. And it shouldn't be a defined benefit program. It should be a defined contribution program. And that's the way you fix it, I think.
I'm wide open to that. And we've discussed that before. The problem is you want to eliminate programs for seniors who have worked their whole life.
No, absolutely not. No, that's where you're wrong. You keep saying that. I think that everybody who has it and it was promised today should get it, right? Seniors absolutely should get it today. But my kids who are, 18, 19, and 20, we're going to say, listen, you put in this much, here's a refund check, and you're not getting anything. Good luck.
Yeah.
That's the way I think it should be for our kids and the grandkids. Not for now, but I'm saying we should eliminate it for in 30 years.
By the way, according to The Guardian, Swedes support the second highest tax burden in the entire world after Denmark, with an average of 48.2%.
You're 100% right, Barry. You're 100% right. That's cumulative, state, municipal, and federal. But the federal level is a flat tax rate of 20%, and the first $54,000 that
According to The Guardian, your tax rate could be as high as 60%. But I'll dig a little bit more into it. But you can't compare Acushnet to New Bedford. You can't compare Sweden to the United States. They're totally different worlds and totally different situations. We have a much greater drug dependency rate in this country. We have, a crime rate that's different. We have so many things that are different that you can't say, well, we're going to take a few bucks from you and be able to pay off everybody's bills. They've got 10 million people. We've got somewhere between 350 and 375 million people. That's a huge difference. Thank you, my friend. I got to hold you. 508-996-0500 is the number. Thanks for waiting. You're next to WBSM.
Hey, Barry. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
You know, not bad. We're not going to pay any of our... the federal government's not going to send us any money for any programs because we're giving it all away, billions of dollars.
Mm.
Just in this war in the Ukraine, over $130 billion. That's why there's no money for anything.
Well, that's an excellent point, and I'm glad you mentioned that. Countries like Sweden don't pay for a defense. We not only pay for our own defense, but we pay for Sweden's defense.
Ryan, how much foreign aid in the billions does Sweden give out? Probably not a heck of a lot.
Yeah.
You know, and the fourth rail is the banking system. I mean, it's teetering on collapse, too. Now, the FDIC, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, you know, they only this over a little over $300 billion they have in the fund. And, you know, with all of these house foreclosures and car repos and all credit cards, I mean, the credit cards, that bubble's going to burst. They don't, and they're borrowing. Banks are loaning out trillions of dollars. There's not enough money in the FDIC to cover everybody's depositors in their bank account. And you know what happens if that fails? Then the FDIC is going to go to the federal government. Then Republicans and Democrats in the House and the Senate and the President, they're going to spend more money. Guess what? You don't have more money because you have $38 trillion in the hole. And the Treasury, U.S. Treasury, is going to go to the Federal Reserve Bank to say, can you loan us more money at high interest? They're going to print more money. It's not federal because it's a private bank. There are no reserves, and it's not a bank. You can't go to the Federal Reserve and deposit and withdraw money. So, you know, this is the house of cards.
Yeah.
But people don't want to hear that. That's why the inflation is so high. We keep spending all our money, and then we have high inflation because our money's becoming worthless.
No, absolutely. And that's the most dangerous threat to this country is the debt and our inability to control spending, because nobody politically wants to do what needs to be done. And that is... that is to reduce spending and to live within our means. And we just don't want to do that.
Let me just say one more thing, Barry.
Yep.
I wouldn't trust my money in the bank even with 100,000 FDIC because they don't got the money to back. If it collapses, your money's going to be gone. We're being lied to by Republicans and Democrats who are spending billions and billions of our dollars into the Ukraine, and no one seems to know where all this money's going.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it. 508-996-0500 is the number. You're next on WBSM. Thanks for hanging on.
Hey, Barry. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Hey, I need some advice. Should I wear my MAGA hat to my son's graduation next week?
Okay.
May 16th, UMass Dartmouth.
Okay.
I'm wondering if there's going to be any protests. I'm worried about my... what should I bring? I mean, I can't bring any weapons to defend myself. So, but I think if I wear my MAGA hat, I might get attacked.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But you know what? I'd wear it just to piss everybody off, personally.
Yeah, and then maybe I can throw my cap in the air when all the graduates, my son graduates and throws it off like that. I mean, just to be part of the action, I might want to do that, but I might jeopardize my my health, and maybe my wife won't be too happy with that, and maybe my son wouldn't, because I'd probably embarrass him. But you can be going on that stage, but I'm wondering if there's going to be any protests in next week because UMass Dartmouth is the 16th. Which is the graduation.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, again, 135 protesters arrested early this morning at UMass Amherst. So I was at UMass yesterday, UMass Dartmouth yesterday and the day before after work, and I didn't see any kind of activity there at all. You know, it's funny. it's kind of weird. I was driving into the onto the campus, and I saw this flag hanging up, and I'm thinking, about, oh, my God, that's the Palestinian flag. So I parked my car and got out and walked over it, and I was like, oh, no, that's just the transgender flag. So I was wrong. No. They look a lot alike. And so
I'm wondering if the protests are not here per graduation ceremony. So, like, they might hit one college one day for the protest, right, and then move on to the next one. So I'm not sure if we're still safe because if they hit, like, different graduation classes, then maybe you messed up and might be prone to that next week.
Well, I mean, if these protesters are upset that UMass has investments in defense companies doing business with Israel, I mean, that's the entire system. It's not just Amherst. So, yeah, that would include Dartmouth and any other one of the, I think there are, what, five campuses. So it would not surprise me to see some kind of a demonstration at UMass on the 16th. Wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, maybe I can broadcast live there. If it's going on, you know, I can maybe call into your radio show and give you a play-by-play of what's going on.
That's on the 16th. Well, that's a Sunday, so we won't be here.
That's a Thursday.
Oh, on a Thursday. Oh, definitely call you. Definitely call from there.
Yeah. I'll be like, Barry, I'm getting beat up. Barry, help me. Send me reinforcements.
Send the white supremacists that Maxine Waters says are up in the hills. Send them to my rescue.
Yeah, Maxine Waters. Is she know something? Here we go. Don't forget, Barry, and our listeners. What they accuse the right of doing is what they're doing. So they might be doing that in the hills, the Democrats themselves, getting ready for the election and what's going to go happen this November. So whatever they accuse us of doing, that's what they're doing.
Well, if there's going to be any violence around election time, before, during, or after the election, it's going to be the left. I mean, they're already out in the streets committing violence. Look what they did during the last election season of 2020, right? Over 500 riots in this country. People were killed. Buildings burned and destroyed and looted and so on and so forth. That wasn't MAGA supporters doing that. So if Maxine Waters is having visions of riots, and she said the Trump's going to unleash his MAGA supporters on black people. So, yeah, I guess you got to get your waters together here. We're going to go attack all the black people we can see after the election. So, I don't know. Woman is crazy. And she's become a millionaire by being a congresswoman. Isn't that amazing?
Well, they all are. They're all millionaires. The only person that became in political office that became political was Donald Trump. He's the one that loses the money. And he's still losing money, say, with all these legal cases. It blows my mind what this man's going to go through to be for this country. It just shows you his stamina and his belief system because of this situation about billions and billions of dollars getting spent on this crusade.
Wouldn't you just love to see him in a meeting room with Putin?
Oh, yeah. And what's his name there from... Ukraine at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, they all be like shaking their boots and stuff. Maybe they have to bunch in the bathroom because they have to go pee.
There you go. Thank you, Paul. I got to hold you. 508-996-0500. I got to do a real quick break. Stay tuned. Your calls are next. Then. All right, 2:35 on a Wednesday afternoon. 508-996-0500 is the number. Bruins on tonight. So totally cool that we've got the Bruins and the Celtics both in the playoffs at the same time, and it's like there's a game every night. I mean, you know, last night we watched the Celtics. Tonight we get to watch the Bruins, and the Celtics are back tomorrow night. This is good stuff, right? Let's hope they keep going. 508-996-0500 is the number. You are next on WBSM. Thanks for hanging on.
Hello, Barry. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. I was listening to your conversation with a gentleman talking about Sweden.
Yes.
And I think the big elephant in the room and it applies to Sweden, it applies to many other places, is that the burden sharing that they don't have to take up in Sweden is our defense budget.
Mm-hmm.
We have like a $781 billion defense budget. And if you're an individual in Sweden and you're buying oil or shirts or pants or housing products, a lot of those products are shipped to Sweden. And the shipping lanes are protected by mostly American warships or Air Force planes and things like that. So there is a tariff on you and I, to some degree, to protect countries like Sweden,
yeah,
who get their goods and services delivered to them without any burden for them getting them from places like Vietnam, where you might get a shirt, or the Saudi Arabia, where you might get your oil. So you and I are paying for that. So the saved money that they have in Sweden allows them, it's nothing to do with tax revenue. We have plenty of tax revenue. We don't need to change our tax system to create more revenue. We have plenty of it. It's the way in which it's allocated. And years ago, when I was a college-age student, 40-odd years ago, many people, many liberals, if you will, were against the defense budget because the defense budget sort of supported the multinationals who were engaged in this trade. And now they don't argue as much now as they used to because it supports their idea of a one-world government or a one-world organization, the new world order, if you will.
Well, you know, so part of what Trump, and this is why Trump was not very popular overseas, is that Trump went to our European allies, too, and yeah, the others in the world, and said, look, you know, the yeah, American people are Germany's got the wealthiest economy in all of in yeah, all of Europe, and yet we're paying a greater percentage toward NATO than you are. We're paying for your defense and everything else. You guys have to start ponying up. I'm looking here in front of me. This is... statistics.com. Sweden's military expenditure as a share of its gross domestic product was around 1% from 2011 to 2019. However, it has increased since, reaching 1.5% in 2023. The country's total military expenditure amounted to 78 billion Swedish Kronor? Is that how you pronounce their
yeah, I think that's the right way. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, but I don't know how that translates into dollars, but 78 billion kronor. It compared to what did you say our defense spending was? $170 billion?
No. 781.
781. Okay. Yeah.
We're up in the, we're up in the stratosphere. So
okay,
I think the last time I looked, was it a couple years ago, if you took the next nine countries and added them all together, they barely reached our number.
Wow.
So if you, again, if you go to Europe and or these countries that, whether it be Sweden, Luxembourg, they have beautiful infrastructure, great retirement plans, great rail service, and things like that. But, yeah, they've saved the money from their obligations for the common defense. So mm, that's where the money is able to be spent.
Yeah, and they do tax the hell out of their people. I mean,
oh,
I wasn't
do.
Yeah,
no,
I wasn't able to dig out the entire tax plan when I was talking to that gentleman. But what I did read is that and more than half of the people pay over 60% of their income in taxes. And so, I mean, again, it's a socialist country. So that goes into a pool. And if you need aspirin or you got to go to the walk-in or whatever, it's paid for. But you've paid for it. It's not like the money doesn't fall out of the sky. You're paying for this. It's just that the government's administering it. And I'm sure determining what procedures you can get, too. If you go to the hospital, they get to tell you whether or not you get that. I mean, nothing infuriates me more than what I'm seeing happening more in this country now is like when my doctor says I need to put you on this prescription, and then I get an email saying, well, sorry, your insurance company's not going to pay for this particular prescription that they've decided you don't need it. Well, what the hell do I need a doctor for if, you know, my insurance company's determining what medicines I need, right? So
yeah,
can you
yeah,
only imagine a socialist? I know when I lived in Burlington, Vermont years ago, people used to pour over the border from Canada because they had socialized medicine in Canada, but they had to wait forever to get in, especially for like elective surgery, and the insurance didn't pay for anything.
Well, chances are if you go, I have friends in England, and if you go to the NHS, most people in middle-class situations, if you will, or maybe even lower middle class, they have a separate doctor under a separate private plan, separate doctors, quote, under private plans. So there's not, it's not completely socialized.
So it's like a supplemental, you know what I mean? Supplemental kind of thing?
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, they'll do it that way.
Big conversation. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it. 508-996-0500 is our number. I got to hit the break. We're coming right back. Stay with us. You're listening to W. And welcome back to 45 on a Wednesday afternoon. A little Stevie Ray Vaughan. I remember when Stevie Ray Vaughan died. He was in a helicopter, if I remember correctly. And the helicopter hit some high tension wires, got tangled up in some high tension wires. God, that was a while ago. Great blues player, great guitar player too, singer. Yeah, like Stevie Ray Vaughan. That was a while ago. Yeah, they had to be around 1990. I want to guess. Somewhere around there. And, boy, time flies, doesn't it? 508-996-0500 is the number to call. So talk a little bit about Social Security. And, again, we're getting one of those warnings. We get it every so many years, every time it seems as though there's an election coming up. But, I mean, I believe there's legitimacy to it, that the Social Security system is in trouble. And we need to figure out a way going forward. And this is one of those topics that nobody wants to talk about because politically... it's one of those hot potatoes. If you go out there and you say, well, Social Security is going to collapse, and so therefore we got to make some changes in the way we do things, immediately the other side makes it a political issue. And this happens all the time in every presidential election. The Democrats will do this. And this is why we have not fixed the Social Security system. Because if the Republicans will say, well, yeah, we need to figure out a different way. Case in point, George W. Bush saying, look, what we need to do is come up with these individual retirement accounts where people can invest their money instead of, you know, having money put aside into a government account that's going to be spent, misspent or whatever, or not properly invested. People can invest money for themselves, for their future, encourage people to do that. Everybody, oh, look, the Republicans are trying to gut Social Security. They want to take your Social Security from you. They want to raise your retirement age. How many times has the retirement age been raised anyway? I mean, I can remember when it was 60 and 62. It's, 65 now, right? And it probably should go up. You know why? Because we are working longer. I know fewer people that retire at 65 than ever before in my lifetime. I mean, people stay younger, longer, and want to work longer. I mean, I can't even imagine what it must be like to just hang around at home all day. I've got my in-laws are in their 90s, and, you know, God bless them. They're here still. They've been retired for years, and they've got nothing to do all day but watch Judge Judy and just hang around and get on each other's nerves and stuff like that. And I'm not suggesting that they go away somewhere. It's just that, you know, people work longer these days, and people should. You stay healthier longer. And to just hang around and do nothing all day would not be for me. Maybe it's for you. I don't know. Or maybe you've made a lot of money in your life and you can retire early and go off and do things. If I hit the lottery and I had all kinds of money to travel or to do things like that, well, yeah, okay, maybe then I'm cool for retiring. But as long as I've got to work, I can't even imagine not having anything to do with my time. So Social Security is something going forward. Yes, we do need to figure it out. We do need to figure it out. We need to start with the younger generations and say this is going to be what's going to happen from this day forward. Either you're on your own, or we've got a different kind of a plan that you can get involved in, the government will help you out with it. But we need to make people understand. And I think young people are starting to understand that they will not have Social Security depend on, that they need to plan for their futures. But still, I mean, we're looking at a day and age here with 61%. 61% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck right now. That number may have gone up a bit because of the stagflation and Bidenomics that we find ourselves living with. So that 61% may be higher than 61% right now. Credit card debt at the highest rate it's ever been. Interest rates, unbelievable interest rates that will keep you in debt forever if you have debt. You'll never pay off your debt. So, I mean, people need to plan for their future. And is Social Security the best program? Probably not. But nobody has had the political will, the political guts to take it on. And we've seen this happen with so many different things in our country. I mentioned earlier, you know, look at the immigrant crisis that we have in this country right now, because nobody has had the guts to deal with immigration policy. Okay. And, you know, the same thing with Social Security, abortion for years and years from 1973 all the way up until just what, last year. Abortion has kind of just languished there and sat there, and it was never a federal law guaranteeing an abortion. It just kind of sat there, and then it was acceptable, and it just kind of, you know, so many things that we don't deal with. Balanced budget, line item veto, all of these different things that we need to deal with, and we don't, because politically they're not expedient. Well, Social Security is one of those things, and we've got to figure out a way to deal with this issue. Because if we don't, it's going to kill us all. I mean, it's really that bad. And older people certainly will not be able to depend on it. But we can't take it away from those who have earned it. You can't say we stop Social Security as of today. You're on your own. No. And people have paid into this for years and years and years. It was a deal. It was an agreement. It was a bargain. You do this, you give us the money, and then later on we're going to give you and match it. And that's where we are today. So all of those who have paid in for their whole lives, you know, they have to be guaranteed Social Security. If you're going to make a change in Social Security, then you got to start it with a younger generation. People are just going into the workforce. All right, we're going to take our last break for the day, and I want to tell you about my friends at Nathan Clark. Your home sold guaranteed realty. Would you like to get 3 cash offers on your home at the price that you want? Well, if you are considering selling, then this is for you. Nathan Clark of Your Home Sold Guaranteed Realty guarantees you multiple cash offers at your price, or Nathan Clark will pay you the difference. This is the easiest, best way to sell your home. There is no need to list it for sale. There is no need for a 3-hour open house every Sunday. There's no need for showings. You sell your house as is, and you can move when you want. I told you about Bob and Linda. Bob and Linda, the couple, they listened to the radio. They heard the ad for Nathan Clark. They wanted to move to Florida, but had to sell their home up here first. They went to NathanClarkTeam.com, entered their information, and received 3 cash offers. Bob and Linda accepted one, chose their closing date, and Bob and Linda now live in Florida in their happiest clams. Nathan made it easy, so they were even able to stay in their home after the closing until all of their details were finalized in Florida. For the number one best way to sell your home, call or text Nathan Clark, Your Home Sold Guaranteed Realty. Call them at 401-232-7661. Once again, that's Nathan Clark, Your Home Sold Guaranteed. All right, let me take the break. We're going to come right back, and maybe get a chance for a call in here before we wrap it up for the day on WBSM. Stay with me.
A little while from now, if I'm not feeling any less sour, I promise myself to treat myself and visit a nearby town. Climbing to the top.
All right, welcome back to the program. Gilbert O'Sullivan here, Alone Again Naturally, probably the single most depressing song I have ever heard in my entire life. And that charted. That was actually a charted song. He had a couple of those. They were pretty bizarre, weird songs, but that was one of them back in the 1970s. He did another one about called Claire. Now, that one wouldn't pass muster today, singing to a little girl named Claire. But that was Gilbert O'Sullivan. I can remember seeing people dancing to that on Bandstand. And you could actually dance to that back in those days. But in any event, we're pretty much out of time here. It is a Wednesday afternoon. It's kind of crummy looking out there. I'm not sure I'm going to get my walk in. I'm hopeful. Radar doesn't show anything nearby, so maybe I'll be able to get a little bit of a walk in this afternoon. But in any event, A lot of interesting stuff. I'll be rooting for the Bruins tonight. Hopefully you will be as well. I mentioned earlier, actually a caller mentioned about the story that I've got posted up on WBSM.com and on our Facebook page today about the history of the Boston Garden. And a shocker for me when I found out what the original name of the Boston Garden was. And it's in the story, so you got to take a look now. You got to go check it out and leave your thoughts, your memories about the Boston Garden. We've all had great memories of the Garden, right? I remember going there as a kid to see wrestling matches and in concerts and in sports later on, more as an adult and an early teenager and so on and so forth. But, the Boston Garden. Also, I had a piece up yesterday about Todd Angeli, the guy who sings the anthem for the Boston Bruins games at home.